Hello and welcome to my now nearly yearly update from the Future Technology Team presentation. So I'm Thorsten Kuckuck. I'm distinguished engineer here at SUSE, and I'm the senior architect for SLES and MicroS, and I'm also leading the Future Technology Team, which is doing whatever I came in my mind or somebody else, writing proof of concepts, do research work or whatever else is there and which doesn't normally fit in our normal processes. So I want to start with SUSE MicroS. You might ask, SUSE MicroS, not OpenSUSE like in the last years? And yes, finally, after a long time and many discussion fights, we really do a SUSE MicroS product. The first version will be 5.0. It's driven by marketing. I would have preferred, in looking back at the SUSE Linux 4.2, a SUSE MicroS 4.2 as first standalone version, but okay. The code base will be compatible with SLI 15 SP2 in the beginning, but we are not SLES. We have different requirements. Some of the things we do with MicroS don't work with SLES, as we would have it already long time ago. So it's also not a small light version of SLES, but in some parts we are different, and which also means we have to fork packages, SLES package for MicroS, and modify them. But in the end, we try to get this as minimal as possible. So use as much SLES code as possible, at least for the beginning, and then let's see what our customers want and where they drive us. We will have a container runtime podman, and we also will provide libvirt to host virtual machines. The delivery will be an installation image, like you know from SLES and all other products, and pre-built images which you can directly deploy on virtualized environment and most likely also on bare metal. So for automatic installation, we will not use AutoJust as many may have expected, but we will go with Yomi. And there's also some new things about remote system management. We don't have Just, but we will use Cockpit. Later more about this. And something really new is SE Linux. Up to now, SE Linux is a checkbox mark item for most of our products. And okay, since Hannes asked, what does it spell for the future of AutoJust? Nothing. We still have SLES, we still need AutoJust there, and depending on the SLES needs, it also will answer then what will happen with AutoJust. But coming back to SE Linux, for SLES, it's a fat mark item, we don't ship a policy. With MicroS, we really want to provide SE Linux with policy which is protecting your containers. So some highlights, I think most are already known from the last years, but for those who are new or listen the first time to this, MicroS has a read-only root file system and is using atomic updates. We use transactional updates as it for it as implementation. It is based on ButterFS with snapshots. And atomic means in this case, either the update is fully applied or it is not applied at all. And an update does not influence the running system. So if you update the container runtime, your containers will not be restarted for it. And if it goes wrong, the system doesn't notify it. The disadvantage of it or the cost of it is, of course, you need to reboot to activate the update or the changes. The advantage is, as it is a read-only root file system, we can always go back to a fully working version. And thanks to HealthChecker, a tool verifying that everything works during boot, we can use it even in a manual, in a fully automatic way without manual interaction. Oh, sorry, too fast.
There are some questions on the chat. I am not sure if you want to
I will
answer
come
them.
later to SE Linux.
I see.
It's another one. For the automatic updates, does it mean we have to restart? Breach update?
Yes. That is how transactional updates or all atomic updates implementation works. You need one atomic trigger, and independent if it is OS tree or the core OS variant of updates or what we are doing with transactional updates, it's always you update a system in the background, and then to switch it, you do have to reboot. Except somebody comes up with an idea how to exchange the root file system in all processes running without a reboot. Then that would be really the big
pivot
thing.
Root? Pivot root?
With running processes changing?
Yeah, sure, that is the point of pivot root.
So you really start everything at that moment. It's then not much different to a reboot. Reboot has some advantages in this space, but later we have later a slide about transactional updates.
Okay.
So we have automatic updates, we have manual and automatic rollback thanks to Hit Checker. A rolling release is possible. On OpenSUSE MicroS, rolling release is normal because Tumbleweed, which we are following there, is a rolling release version, and thus MicroS is too. SUSE, more closely to SLES, is no rolling release in this regard, as SLES is not rolling release. But we can do a rolling release, which means if SLES comes out with a new service pack, and on SLES you have to manually move to a manual change to the new service pack version. This can be done all transparent, fully automatical on a MicroS system. We could even update from SLE 12 to SLE 15, and most likely also to SLE next, whatever this will be, without the need of shutting down the system, whatever, because everything is done in the background on a hidden copy of the system. MicroS also introduced at first tempfs for slash temp. The reason was that if temp is growing and it's on the main root partition, then it's eating up the space we have for normal updates. And normally on a container host OS, you don't want static data flying around in temp. So with every reboot, we will clean temp on it. Meanwhile, also Tumbleweed followed it, and there's also tempfs for slash temp. So web pages, we also worked on the web pages for OpenSUSE MicroS in the last weeks. We have a new entry page since 1 or 2 weeks, micros.opensuse.org. We have a new download portal where you can better select the images you want. And also the documentation was more streamlined and updated. So the tooling. Transactional updates. Since people not yet familiar with it. Currently, we are still unique because with ButterFS and SnapFots, it's hard to clone for our competitors. This advantage will go away in the future because Fedora is now also using or plans to use ButterFS for their desktop systems, and there are already people working on getting SnapFots and rollbacks implemented on Fedora with this, which means in the end they have then our transactional update, everything they need for it. It's very space efficient. If you look at CoreS, for example, you have two big partitions for slash user, and you switch between these partitions with every reboot. So on the one side, you have a lot of duplicate code and empty space twice. On the other side, if your data is growing too much for your system, you will run into a space problem. You have to repartition to have more space. So we can start with one big partition and can then store as many snapshots as the space allows. Currently, we are also the only one who provides who includes slash etc, so the configuration files, in the snapshot and do a real rollback for them. Most other distributions or all have etc outside of their snapshot and rollback system, So, if you, for example, update to a new Apache version with a complete new configuration or config files, and then you do a rollback, you have the old Apache version installed with the new configuration files. This does not work. And with our implementation, this is not the case. We solved that and can do a real rollback also of the configuration files. So we use RPMs for it. So nothing new to learn for packagers. Also, third-party vendors, hardware vendors, whoever can continue to provide their RPMs built for Sleth or Tumbleweed for MicroS. And since we have are not limited to partitions to switch to a new version, we are much more flexible in the size and in the ground possibility. So that is the old stuff I told the last years already. What is really new is that we are working or have nearly finished a C++ library for this with a command line tool in front end. So it should be much easier to integrate transactional update in other tools for this. For the first boot, most of the people use CloudInit or now CloudInit from the public cloud. CloudInit is overkill for our usages if you want to personalize an image in KVM or bare metal, whatever, at the first boot. And it does not, or by design, is not able to do everything we need, like repartition the system at the first boot because it's running from the running system. So you cannot really repartition or create new partitions for var, whatever we want to need. That's why we are looking at Ignition from CoreOS. It's running from the init RAMFS. So it can modify the system before we boot into it and modify it. It can partition and format this. It can write files, enable system services, and create users. That's already all it can, but that's normally enough for what you need. What's missing here is installing packages, but that would be also a problem with the only root file system and transactional update we have. The disadvantage of Ignition is that it's getting more fat and fat in the last time, which makes booting slower. And the upstream development is not going in a direction which fits our needs, but they are very Fedora CoreOS centric specific, and this is partly incompatible with what we are doing. And it's not flexible enough, as I said already. You cannot install additional packages. And if you modify the root file system from Ignition, then you have to do a reboot to activate the changes. That's why Fabian from my team did came up with Combustion. He wrote that. It's a minimal module for Dracut. It runs user-provided scripts on the first boot. It loads the configuration from an external storage. The requirement on the system is it must use transactional updates because Combustion creates a new snapshot from the initrd. It makes some modifications to it, like installing additional files or packages, set up devices, repartition the hard disk. And afterwards, you don't need to reboot to activate the changes, but we will directly boot into the new snapshot. So this solves the problem of MicroOS and installing packages at the first boot, which are missing and requiring a second reboot. This is no longer necessary, but we can all do in one boot, in one case. SE Linux, there was a question, why SE Linux? So one big problem currently is if you escape the SE Linux container, then you have access to the real file system and you can read and execute the files there. AppArmor is not really helping here because you should be able to read the configuration files inside of the container, but not outside. So if you work with the path and everything, it's an identical and you will get again access to it. And the nice thing with SE Linux in this case is the labels inside of the container are difference in outside. I, for example, mounted by accident the wrong volume into a container, and then SE Linux prevented that the container could access the data on it. So that is exactly what we want and need in this case. Also, it's well known outside of the OpenSUSE and SUSE world. The last time I was on the embedded conference beginning of this year, the people either had now system, labeling system, whatever to, or security in this regard, or they were using SE Linux. There was nobody who was looking or using UpArmor, and using SE Linux also helps us. We can copy all upstream work in this regard, and it worked out of the box immediately when we installed it the first time on a micro OS system. So no exit. Also another plan is to use no exit for all writable parts of the file system. The first try was pretty disappointing because our tools execute scripts everywhere, even in etc. So in etc, it's not upstream, but most of the packages are, or all I found was that our packagers were installing additional scripts in etc instead of user share or user lib exit wherever they belong. So that needs to be fixed before we can make etc no exit. Temp is the same. We have a lot of applications creating temporary scripts in temp and execute them. Same for temp. And for varlib, the fan food systems also need execute flex. So no exec is requested by some partners for their projects, but currently I will be really happy if you can achieve this for etc. Mid to long term, maybe even temp, but I don't see that for all writable parts. But that's also something we should always have in mind for new packages or when we make system changes. There are still open customer requirements. One is detect offline modifications. So if somebody has physical access to a hard disk and the machine is switched off, you can modify the data on it. And at the next boot, the system should detect that the system was modified. The file system integrity verification in ButterFS from Johannes Samfern, what he started, looked very promising to us, but that looks like that stopped whatever since MICE is here. But I had no time and my team also to dig deeper into it, what's the status there and what else you can use instead. So if somebody has ideas for offline modifications detections, we are always happy to hear about it. There's also the full disk encryption with, where we also had now time to really solve all usability and practical problems around them. Cockpit. As I said, we want to go away from Yast, and there are two reasons. One is Yast is not yet adjusted to a transactional update system. Yast has many modules, packages, puts in many requirements, makes the system much bigger. And another thing is Yast is either NCurses or X11 Windows, which if you look at a desktop system or a single machine where this is coming from, is absolute fine, helpful, good. But if I think about if I have to manage the BIOS or firmware of my team server, I connect to the firmware of my team server with a web browser. And then I have a graphical firmware. I can adjust all things, variables in it. I can reboot the machine. I can shut power them down. I can power them up. But if I then go from the hardware level to the software level, so to the OS level, I have either a not very user-friendly or Yast NCurses interface, or I have a bandwidth-eating X11 interface, or I have to hack around with VNC and similar things. And why not doing the same, just use web interface. And there is Cockpit. It's supporting all Linux distributions except SUSE. There are packages for everything. So my team started packaging Cockpit when they found it and made the proposal. And we can do some things already in it. So we have Podman containers we can manage with it. We can look for the log files, yield status. What's missing, the most important parts are package management and network management. And we need to adjust this ADLinux module to all the work here for a beginning. So there, somebody mentioned at least EMA does for the offline detection approach. We tried with EMA and EVM. We spoke with the upstream developers, and currently EMA is not yet in a state that it is really usable for that case. It has some problems. Like if you delete the write file on the disk, then it's disabled and it doesn't even notice that it is disabled and shouldn't be. So we looked at EMA, EVM, and that was not yet in a state that it's usable for us. That was to Jan Kara's comment about EMA. The size, last year when Richard made this presentation for me, a minimal MicroS installation virtualized needed nearly 500 megabyte on disk space. The biggest packages were the kernel default base, Perl and Python. This year we are around 320 megabyte, much better. And a big thanks here to the kernel team who got the kernel and the firmware packages much, much smaller. That helps a lot. But we were also getting rid of the main Perl package. We have only a few packages left who need the main, the Perl base package, only the interpreter. And we got completely rid of Python. So now Python code is in the default installation, the minimal. And this allows us to come down to a little bit over 300 megabyte. If you look at the package sizes, kernel default base is still the biggest one and will stay the biggest one. We need the kernel. Grub with the Grub plugins is the second biggest one. I'm really wondering that the bootloader is nearly as big as the kernel. Glibc local base is also with nearly 30 megabyte really fat. And what we also is questionable is FileMagic, which is currently pulled in by Dracut. That's something we need to look at to get this even smaller. But the easy big things are solved. So now it's really going down and getting small things removed or solved or even more smaller to really save more this space. So my dream here would be really a minimal container host. We don't need all this feature-rich tools. In the end, the BusyBox tooling is most of the time enough. Bootloader kernel, libc systemd. If we could replace tools like coroutils, findoutils, z, grep with BusyBox, it would be nice. But for coroutils and findoutils, currently don't see that because of too many low-level core packages really using the extended functionality of this. But our DVD creator also replaced already gzip with BusyBox gzip because that's smaller and it works. So it would be possible to replace at least some of the tools with something smaller. And since every workload should run in a container, the interaction with the host system itself is really low and should not be there at all in the best case. Dominic and I looked last year at MuseLibc, like Science Alpine Linux is using them. That would be really nice if you could have a demo, proof of something, whatever with that. But the patches you need for binutils, GCC, RPM, whatever, I don't remember exactly, they're far too big and too intrusive and far too much work to really get something bootstrapping and building. But we have many low-level tools for around bootloader, kernel modules, and similar things like Perl bootloader. which are partly knobs, so don't do anything today, only there for compatibility, or because nobody really understands anymore if they're needed, for what they're needed, and nobody wants to look or try to get rid of them. And this is something where we really need to look at to make these things again simpler and get rid of the overhead there. So Yomi, yet one more installer. Yomi was written by mostly Alberto. It's a salt-based auto installer. You define the system via salt states and pillars, and then salt either standalone or connected to a salt master will then install the system and set it up. The advantage is you can immediately give it over to then SUSE manager, for example, who can then continue to manage the system. Currently, x86-64 and ARM machines with an UEFI firmware are supported, with more needs, requirements, and more resources, we can also add more things to it. Another thing is SUSE Manager, Salt, and MicroS. That was one of the biggest roadblockers until today. As example, if you have a salt state which checks if Apache 2 is installed, if not, installs it, verifies that the VIOS is configured, if not, configures it, make sure the Apache 2 service is enabled, and restart the service if its configuration fails have changed, is a typical salt state, but we have a read-only root file system, so most of this is not able. So what happens on the MicroS system up to today? If you want to install Apache 2 because it's not installed, you cannot install it because it's on a read-only root file system, so you have to call transaction update, but then it's only in a snapshot, not yet activated because a sales state does not reboot, so it's not visible, and since it is not visible, the next check, if it's really now installed, will also fail, and in worst case, you end in an endless loop or error out at some point, and that's not the expected result here. Same if you continue with checking if the vhost is configured. If Apache is installed only in a snapshot, not attributed, it's not found, so we cannot check the configuration, we cannot enable the service, and so on. And Alberto for my team, together with Ignatz, modified transaction update and salt for it. We have now a new module, transaction update, which exposes the transaction update command line interface. We made changes to the run, call, apply, single SHI state, states, modules, applications from salt. And what happens now, if you use the standard salt state, and we are on a traditional OS like Tumbleweed or SLES, everything will continue to work as before. If we are in a micro system, so with a read-only file system, with transaction update, then we will open a transaction, install, configure, and enable Apache all in the snapshot. So we don't create several snapshots, but one and reopen it again and again to make the additional modifications. And afterwards, a reboot is triggered. And you can ask the state if a reboot is pending or not, whatever is required there. And all this logic is or will become upstream. There are already pull requests for it. And salt will auto-detect what to use. So no extra configuration should be required. If you have several salt states depending on each other, I'm not sure if it will always work. And because of this, you can also configure everything. So you can tell salt exactly, do this all in a transaction, even if you think it should not go in a transaction or whatever. For more explanations, whatever, please ask Alberto in my team. He is expert in it. I have only a high level overview about it. Another nice thing we were working on is Git and OBS. So we created a proof of concept. The requirement did come from a partner, from a project with a partner together. So the partner wanted to be able to easier submit patches, whatever, and they didn't want to learn use OBS, but Git for this. So we created a proof of concept, OBS to Git, which means we fetch all informations, including the metadata from OBS, and create a Git repository where we store all the data, and then can modify them there with normal pull requests and Git commands. And on the other side, create a command which reads the Git repository and recreates an OBS project from it. The implementation is OBS Git in the GitHub directory from Alberto Planas. And there is an Etherpad page with all the background, what could come next, how to productize this proof of concept to make it usable, working for many people, not only for the single special project. Then we made some proof of concept with containers. The most biggest and important one, in my opinion, is running our AMT in a Kubernetes cluster. So why should I create an own machine installing AMT on it with all the problems or advantages depending on your view? If I have a Kubernetes cluster, so we created, or we have already had some OpenSUSE, official OpenSUSE container images. We created the missing ones. We created a manifest, which you can use to deploy AMT on your Kubernetes cluster. And now we have several containers, one for the AMT daemon, one the database, Nginx. Has the advantage, if one Nginx server is overloaded, you can start more of it without any problems. And we use BusyBox and MariaDB client to synchronize between all the containers that they start and initialize in the right order. So the biggest change was more or less in the AMT, that AMT does not expect and require that everything is running on one host, because in the end, you can see one container as one host, but that you can put it on several hosts or containers. And this also means that the locking is no longer done on the local file system, but that we now lock operations in the MariaDB database. Because if you lock it only on the local system and then you access the database from another system, the lock is not seen and you have again corrupt data there. And another, not really proof of concept, but real deployment is a server which acts at authoritative name server and is also a DHCP server for the local virtual machines running with libvirt. We installed this on our big fat Teams server. So running all the VMs there, but bind and DHCP are containerized. Was quite some fun and took us quite a long time to get all the dependencies and configuration right. We don't want to start the containers too early because then they would never update at the first start. But on the other side, don't want to start them too late, else your VMs don't work or libvirt DNS masks are grabbing all the ports. But meanwhile, it's working fine since several weeks without any issues. And all our, what we found out, is now part of the container systemd package, which contains many systemd service files to run the official OpenSUSE container images with systemd, or manage them with systemd, start, stop them, and update them. So that's already for me. This gives us about 10 minutes for more questions. I haven't followed the chat yet because it's too disturbing. Is there anything open I need to answer? Are the questions around SE Linux and transaction update answered?
I don't think there is anything in particular that needs answering, but yeah, Lukasz was pointing out some of the details about what Yast supports and not. And then we had some discussions about IMA and the, where the keys are stored and stuff like that, but nothing directed to you, I guess.
Okay. So, are there more questions? We have a lot of time still left to answer questions. Daniel Morgan is asking, what are the primary use cases for MicroS as a product? The primary use case will be container host OS or as OS for the edge. So we had some interesting calls with customers last week, which are currently using Windows for the edge, and MicroS would be the Hector has a looping. And MicroS would be the perfect fit for them to replace Windows with Linux. And this replacing Windows with Linux is a requirement of their customers. So edge specifically is something which is, I would say, not defined at all. It's a marketing term. In the end, it means you have something small and need to work independent, and but on the other side get all your data, everything from a cloud, whatever. So as some examples, think about a train. A modern train has about 400 sensors. So you will watch the sensors in the train, but you cannot immediately send them to the cloud most of the time if you're in a tunnel, whatever. So all relevant data will be evaluated on the train, and the rest, big data, will be then sent to the public cloud, where big machines will look at what is the status of this train. And if it then goes to the, what's called repair for in the repairs in the evening, they immediately know what they need to do there. Another use case for edge is mobile phones. So if you think about the mobile phone stations, they have small computers which need to act independently, but on the other side get via LTE whatever their updates and new images implemented. So. So Jiri Berg has more complaints about non-exhibit APTC. I agree to him, but things like OpenVPNs, client app scripts, or whatever are not necessarily the use case of the customers who requested this. I'm pretty sure if we provide a non-executable ETC, this will be a configuration option for these customers who want it and don't use anything which needs executable scripts there. I don't expect that this will be something we will enable always for every product or whatever. Okay. So it looks like that we are all new, many discussions, but not really questions.
I have a question. I don't know if you can hear me.
Yes.
Okay. How do you compare ButterFS snapshots for the update mechanisms with OS3 or CA Sync? Have you evaluated those?
We looked at OS3, and OS3 in the end is doing what we are doing only in the initRD. So OS3 is, I link everything together from different directories to one place, while we use ButterFS for it. So in this regard, they are very similar. When we looked at OS3, the RPM OS3 was not that far well supported, and RHEL Atomic wasn't using RPM OS3, but only OS3. And they had the big problem that customers wanted to install RPMs, their additional drivers for their hardware, whatever. So at some point in time, some Red Hat engineers told us with MicroS that we made it correct and they made it wrong with RHEL Atomic, and that's why they switched to RPM OS 3 later. Currently, I don't see any advantage of OS 3 over transactional update, besides that OS 3 works on every file system and not only with ButterFS on the one side. On the other side, you need to take more care about sibling everything you need to do in user land, which ButterFS is doing out of the box because it's the design of the file system.
Right, thanks. And how does that integrate with bootloaders for the ButterFS case?
So for ButterFS, you tell ButterFS file system, this is your new root partition, and then the bootloader will boot it at the next time. And it's the same, you can do easy rollback by just marking another snapshot older one as this is now your new root partition, or going back in the, or select it in the grub menu. I'm not sure if it is that easy with OS 3 or how they have implemented this doing in rollback.
Okay.
I don't.
And then for SA Linux, have you also considered AppArmor?
As I said, currently we are using AppArmor, and AppArmor is not able to prevent you to access the file system if you escape from the container. And the 6 or 7 biggest security problems with containers in the last years was always an escape of the container. There is a really good FOSDEM presentation from Dan Welch about SE Linux on containers. If somebody is really interested in SE Linux on containers, I can really only suggest to listen to that presentation. He really explains in details what the advantages and problems are. So SE Linux has also problems with containers. If you want to do too much, so if you want to escape a container, then you need some configuration work much more than with AppArmor. But as I said, as example, I mounted the wrong volume into a container, and SE Linux forbids the container to access the wrong data inside of it, but I mounted inside it. And this is something you cannot do with AppArmor at all.
So, okay, thank you very much.
So Stefan wanted to know is the snapshots containing the configuration on /2? Yes, of course. So /, has signed /12GA, the updates, the configuration files in the updates, and they will also be rolled back if you do a rollback. That was one of the big marketing points Matthias Eckermann used in presentations. And Yumi is XX, and will this come from other platforms too? So we need to see how we can load the OS, how to configure it. As I said, it's pure question of resources and time. Somebody needs to sit down and implement it if it is missing, or finds out how to do it correct. Or maybe it's already possible to do, but we don't know it. So 2 minutes left.
Okay. One quick question is how difficult do you think it is replacing core utils with BusyBox?
Next to impossible, because for example Dracode uses some of the extended functionality of copy and so on to also copy metadata attributes. I'm not sure if it is not even needed for SE Linux in this case, which BusyBox does not provide. Some time ago, somebody looked at if you can build core utils as one binary like BusyBox and then link everything to it, but I don't know what happens to that project. So while you can replace ported to BusyBox in containers easily. There are very few BusyBox space containers in the cubic world which really require core utils. Low level tools creating a setup to boot the system, which you don't need to do in a container, has completely different requirements, and there I currently don't really see it. But somebody with more experience and more time has to look at every single fail if you boot with BusyBox and check if it can be changed and what needs to be done. It's at first a big research work.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. I think we are then at the end of the time. Then. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you,
Thorsten.
All.